Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Good morning and a very warm welcome to Christchurch Sidcup today, the 7th of February. Wherever you're watching this service, you're very welcome. I do hope you'll be able to join in with the songs and also benefit from the ministry of God's Word as it's read and preached later in the service by Adam Curtis, our curate, and as we pray together to God, aware that the times we're living in are quite unlike anything probably any of us have ever known. God knows all about it, and he says to us through his Son Jesus Christ, "Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden," and he promises us rest. So let's pray as we start our service that we will find that rest today as we come to him. Heavenly Father, as we come to your Son, Jesus Christ, today, give us the rest he promised through the ministry of the Holy Spirit and through the encouragement of this service now. For we ask it, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. I didn't introduce myself. My name's Tom Parsons. I'm the vicar at Christchurch, and I'm thrilled that you've joined this service. Let's now give God the glory in the words of our first hymn.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement sin, and open the gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. A perfect creation, a purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God, the highest render, who truly believes.
Is often caused by our circumstances, which can be difficult. But very often, our weariness is a result of the fact that we look constantly elsewhere for our strength, our support, and we trust in all sorts of other things, things that are not God, to give us our comfort, our relief, our joy, and our peace. This is part of our sinfulness, that we continually look away from the true and living God and turn to these other things instead. So let's come now to confess our sin. The way in which we do that, it comes out in the things we say and think and do as well, as well as in our attitudes and the things we desire. So let's now use these words to confess our sin, coming to God our Father in Jesus' name for forgiveness, saying together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Jesus came into the world to give us rest, and part of that meant lifting the burden from us onto himself, the burden of guilt, and carrying that to the cross where he was crucified in our place, that we may receive his life. So he takes our burdens, he gives us his rest. And so now in prayer we receive that rest in faith, asking that we will know it by the power of the Holy Spirit, not because that's what we deserve, but because that is what you have given through your beloved Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
In Christ Club during lockdown 3, which is the 8 to 11s group, we have been thinking about the I am sayings of Jesus in John's Gospel. So firstly, I am the bread of life, John 6. Our bodies need food to live, but food won't get us to heaven. Our hearts need Jesus. When we accept Jesus into our hearts, we will live forever. Plus, he makes it so that we are satisfied. I am the light of the world, John 8. The world is dark with sin, but Jesus gives us light. He takes our sin away and shows us, like a torch, how to walk in the dark and where to go next. I am the gate for the sheep, John chapter 10. In the sheep pen, the shepherd was like a gate or door, letting sheep in and protecting them. Jesus is the gate to God, the only one. We have to go through the gate or door to see God and be saved from our sins. I am the good shepherd, John chapter 10. Just like a shepherd takes care of sheep, Jesus takes care of us. He will do anything to save his sheep, even die for them, maybe if a wolf attacked. And that's what he had to do so that we might have life. I am the resurrection and the life. When Jesus rose again, he defeated death. Death doesn't have to make us afraid anymore if we have Jesus in our hearts. Not only that, but Jesus is life. Those who follow him have life to the full. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John chapter 14. Jesus is the only way to God. He is everything true. He is life for those who follow him. I am the true vine, John chapter 15. Jesus is the vine, his followers are the branches. The branches need to have the vine to grow. If they don't, they're going to fall off and be no good. We all need to stay connected to Jesus through his word, church, and prayer in order to grow.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name up high. Lord, I lift your name up high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save me.
Freedom from human rules. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with the idle notions by their unspiritual mind. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belonged to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These are rules which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom, with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body. But they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence.
Let us pray. Our mission focus this week is CPAS. CPAS is an Anglican evangelical mission agency. Every year they appoint mission-minded clergy to around 100 vacant posts. They run training events and provide resources to equip leaders. And then there is the Venture and Falcon Holidays. John Dunnett, General Director of CPAS, highlights three areas for prayer: the leadership webinars, and James Lawrence, who is responsible for that area of their work, the Falcon Camps, or School Ventures, and Tim Friend, who is responsible for that area of their work, and the patronage parishes where there are vacancies. And that comes under the responsibility of Mike Duff, who is responsible for that area of work. Lord, we uphold the work of CPAS in our prayers. Amen. We pray for the nations around the world and their leaders, that they would be outward looking and have a spirit of cooperation as they address the issues around the pandemic and the vaccination process. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our nation. We thank you for our Queen and the example she sets. Thank you for the positive influences that encourage and inspire us to be outward looking in a time when it is very easy to become isolated and inward looking. We thank you for and uphold the NHS in our prayers, for the staff that work so long and hard to care for us. We pray for wise leadership and good governance in our country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for us as individuals here at Christchurch Sidcup, our community, and those that join us online nationally and internationally, that we would encourage one another with our words, support each other with our actions, and uphold each other in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, join with me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
My steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to Him. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not but through Christ. By my side, the Saviour, He will stay. I labour on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. I hope.
Hello, my name is Adam Curtis and I'm the curate here at Christ Church. And I want to start by telling you a story. A story about an emperor who is incredibly rich and incredibly vain. And he wants the whole world to be looking at him. And so he sets out to find the greatest garments which he can possess. And his announcement is sent all over the nation. And this old lady comes to him and says, "Emperor, I can make you an outfit with linen as pure as air, as soft as breath." And the emperor's like, "Whoa, I've got to get this." So he commissions her to make him a beautiful outfit. And so off she goes and spins away, and then she brings it to him and says, "Come, feel this. It is as soft as air." And he is amazed by it. So he takes off everything he's wearing and he puts on his new outfit, his new underwear, his new trousers, his new shirt, his new robe. And he's so thrilled, he storms out into the courtyard full of his servants and he says, "Look at me, don't I look glorious?" And everyone's standing there slightly shocked, but they're like, "You look great, you look great." And then he's like, "Get my horse, get the trumpeters, tell the city that I'm coming out so they can all come and look at me." And he jumps upon his horse and he starts to ride out into the city. And as he's riding through the city with a trumpeter announcing that he is coming, everyone starts to look at him. And then they start to giggle. And then they start to howl. Because this emperor in his new clothes is absolutely starkest. Now this old story is a wonderful introduction into today's passage. Because the emperor had the illusion of clothes. And what's going on in this early church in Colossians was some people, false teachers, are starting to come into this early church and tell them about other illusions, the illusions of spiritual growth. As the emperor said, "Try on these new clothes and you're going to look amazing," people are saying to this little early church, "Well, try these new spiritual programs and you're really going to grow." And Paul is writing to this church because he wants to warn them that these programs are nothing but illusions. And the first one we see is this illusion of legalism. The illusion of legalism. Look down with me at chapter 2, verses 16. "Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to religious festivals, a new moon celebration or a Sabbath day. These are shadows of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ." Now this illusion of legalism, it looks really appealing because, well, it's something we can control. We can decide ourselves as we're going to engage in these festivals, in these celebrations. We're in control of our own fate. And there's also something quite convincing about them as well. Because if you look at all these things, keeping the Sabbath, these religious celebrations, this new moon festival, well, none of them in themselves are bad. In fact, in 2 Chronicles, the priests are commanded to keep them. So these aren't bad things. These are all good Jewish customs. And note also that Paul doesn't dismiss using them and celebrating them. But he says, well, don't let anyone judge you if you're not doing them. Because once you have Jesus, these things, they're no longer necessary. They're good, but they're not necessary. The clothes of legalism, well, they're clothes which we can recognize. And for us today, legalism will have a different sort of flavor. But at its heart, it is the same thing. It is turning something good and making it necessary. Take fasting, for example. I occasionally fast, and I found it really helpful with my prayer life. It teaches my body that I need to depend upon the Lord, and it focuses my mind in my prayers. However, if I started saying, well, you all have to be fasting every single week, and I was like, that is the only way spiritual growth, you've got to start doing it. Well, I'll be turning something good, well, into something which is suddenly necessary, into this illusion of legalism. And next up, we have the illusion of mysticism. Look down with me at verse 18. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great details about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Now the power of mysticism, well, it's sort of found in its name. It is a mystery. Whoa, what has that person got? I've never experienced anything like that before. I've got to have that. I want to see what they've seen. I want to know what they know. I want to experience what they experienced and I haven't got. But as this passage tells us, it is dangerous. It is dangerous because this worship of angels which is going on, well, it isn't connected to the head. And the head is a metaphor for Jesus. Jesus is the head and the body is the church. And this mysticism, where it's not connected to the head, it's got nothing to do with Jesus. And if it's got nothing to do with Jesus, then it's got nothing to do with the infinite source of wisdom which Jesus is, this ocean of wisdom which we are able to swim in. And for us today, well, this probably looks like Gospel Plus. Taking the wonderful news of the gospel and someone saying, you've got the gospel, amazing, now you just need this extra thing. Whether that be, oh, you just need a second blessing from the Holy Spirit, or you just need this religious experience, you just need that and then you've got it, then you've made it. Then we have the illusion of asceticism. Look down with me at chapter 2, verse 20. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have the appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Well, Dr. Google defines asceticism as severe self-discipline and avoiding of all forms of indulgence. And there's something particularly appealing about asceticism because it, well, has an appearance of wisdom and, well, it's got the appearance of just great humility. Oh, you're willing to do that to yourself? And it looks from the outside like real worship. So, wow, you're willing to suffer that much. You must really love the Lord. And so it can be incredibly appealing. But fundamentally, it is totally useless. It's based on human ideas. It doesn't even work. It is, at the end of the day, clothes without any cloth. Now, these are but illusions of spiritual growth. The illusion of legalism. The illusion of mysticism. The illusion of asceticism. But that doesn't mean that the reality does not exist. That doesn't mean that real clothes are not available. So how do we grow? How do we spiritually grow? Well, remember the truth which we've seen in Colossians again and again. Those who have Christ need nothing more but more of him. So what then is the alternative we are given to legalism? Well, it's finding the reality in Jesus Christ. Because all the things Paul listed, well, they're good things. Religious festivals, good. This new moon celebration, it was good. Celebrating the Sabbath, those are good things. But they are but shadows of the reality. And if we hold fast to these shadows, well, it would be a bit like if you're meeting a friend to go for a walk on a sunny day and you're at your meeting point and then you suddenly see their shadow coming along and you start to think, oh, and you start talking to the shadow and having a conversation with the shadow. That would just be ridiculous. Because the shadow, well, it points us to the reality, which is the friend you're meeting. It points us to the reality, which is Jesus Christ himself. And what is the alternative to mysticism? Well, it's doing the opposite to what the false teachers do. The false teachers, they weren't holding fast to the head, to Jesus Christ. So that's the opposite of mysticism, is holding fast to the head, holding fast to Jesus Christ. If we do that, then we're going to grow as God causes us to grow. What is the alternative to asceticism? Well, remember that you've died with Christ. And notice what particularly you've died to. Let's look down at verse 20. Look down at verse 20 with me. Oh, seem to have lost it. look down at verse 20. Since you've died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why is there you still belong to the world? Do you submit to its rules? You've died particularly to the elemental spiritual forces of this world. And what are those spiritual forces? Well, I did a little bit of reading around the topic, and then there's a few, I think, good suggestions. There's the idea that they could just be very just evil sort of forces and evil sort of powers. The idea that they could be natural sort of forces, particularly given that context of the pagan worship, which would have been going on back then, and how people would have worshipped the sun so that they could get a good harvest, and would be really scared that if they don't fulfill their obligations to the elements, that actually their families will suffer because of it. But then there's also, it could just be reference to the devil himself. But whatever exactly, precisely it means, the answer is always the same. We have died with Christ, and Christ in his death has conquered the elemental spiritual forces. He has conquered the devil. He has conquered every evil power. He has conquered the natural forces of this world. So why do we need to know all these things? Why do we need to be told about these illusions? Because they're dangerous. They're dangerous because they can take us away from Jesus. I had a buddy back in university. For now, let's call him Patrick. And Patrick had a wonderful, humble sort of faith, really devoted man. He was a lovely guy. And tragically, he got very, very ill, and this sort of like ruined his career plans. And Patrick, he wanted to get better, and he had all this time on his hands, so he started to like surf the internet. And as he was surfing the internet, he found this American Christian mystic sort of group. And he's become really like interested and really amazed by what they were offering, that they could heal him. And so he flew over to America, and he spent quite a bit of time with them, and he did everything he was told to do, and was at all night prayer vigils, and was going through all these spiritual sort of programs. But after a certain time, like, he wasn't any better. And so he flew home, and when he got home, like, his faith was just diminished. And to this day, I don't know if he's ever gone to church again. These illusions, they're dangerous, because they take us away from Christ. And what we need, if we want to grow, if we want to develop, if we want to mature, is more of him. Let me finish with another story from the land of the emperor and his new clothes. Many, many miles away in a far and distant city, there lived a poor girl, a pauper. And she was going to get married to a prince. But as her wedding day approached, she started to get really nervous. Oh, I've got no money for a wedding dress. All I've got is rags. And she heard about this woman who could make garments as fine as air. And she was like, oh, maybe that's what I'll need. And then I'll look magnificent for my prince. And her prince heard about this. And he came to her and he said, my love, you have nothing to fear. You don't need her and those garments. I'm a prince. I have wealth in abundance. And I will buy you the most wonderful wedding dress. So on that day, you will look magnificent. We who have Christ need nothing more. We just need more of Christ.
Give me more of Jesus. Take me deeper into what he did. Give me more understanding of the reality of him and his love and his salvation. These are prayers that God the Father will answer by his Spirit, showing us more of Jesus in the Bible, giving us more experience of his presence in our lives as we trust in him. And so let's keep connected to Jesus, the reality. And we are going to pray now as we finish our service that that will be what happens this week as we look to him each day. Father God, we pray that you will create this desire in us for more and more of him, Jesus, and that you will satisfy that desire as only you can by the power of your Spirit, that we will know the living power of Jesus Christ in our lives, helping us to say no to the darkness and to turn to the light and to live in it with power, confidence, and joy. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us this day and always. Amen.